Well, I hope you can see my screen.
Yeah.
You can start to record better. Okay. Well, then let me start AnalyticsCreator. Okay, and today I will create the small SAP data warehouse. First, I have to create new repository. I will call it SAP DWH. And the new repository will be created. Repository, this is a database located on MySQL server, and this database contains a full description of the data warehouse. And the new repository now will be generated. Okay. Well, okay, the first what I will do is to create the new connector to the SAP system. There are two ways to create the new connector. I can add a connector to the existing SAP system, or I will, in our case, get the connector information stored in my account on the cloud. This is the predefined SAP connector containing information about the SAP tables related to SAP FI area. You can see there is a definition of different SAP tables related to SAP FI. And now I will start Data Warehouse Wizard to generate the data warehouse, or the draft version of the data warehouse. There are the tables already stored in my connector, and I will select some of them. Backup F, PSEC, customers, vendors, accounts, company codes, and document types. I will create the Kimball data warehouse with facts and dimensions, and every table I will use to create the dimensions, and I will create the fact transformation from the booking position table by SAG. Okay, and I think I can start. Now, AnalyticsCreator will analyze the structure of the source tables and will prepare the draft version of the data warehouse, which we later can change, can modify, can extend. But important is the draft version of the data warehouse can be created very quick. In this case, it is equal if you use the meta connector containing the definition of the SAP tables, or if you connect to the SAP system. But important is if you use meta connectors, you can create the SAP data warehouse without to have access to the SAP system. And the data warehouse can be connected to your SAP system later when you deploy your data warehouse. Okay, we need five minutes more. I hope it's almost ready. Well, now you can see the data layer diagram, or data flow diagram of your data warehouse. From the left to the right, there are different layers. Source layer containing the information about our sources. Staging layer, where we import the data to. Persistent staging layer containing historized tables. Core layer, there we have different transformations. and data mart layer containing facts and dimensions. What we additionally have to do, we can see that, for example, in our data mart layer, there are two tables, doc types and calendar dimensions, which was created in the Waha wizard. They are not connected to the fact transformation. And let's connect these two tables. This is the fact transformation. And first, I will create the calendar. I will add calendar dimension to this fact transformation. There is a table backup F booking headers. And in this table, this is the table number two, there is a field booking date, pull dot. And but instead to use the bootdot field, I will have there the ID from calendar dimension, which okay, corresponding the field from calendar dimension, ID from calendar dimension. To do that, I will use the macro subdate to ID. Later, I can explain you what how the macros work. And okay, and I will call it FK. Save. And additionally, I will add one more table. This is the table one the moment. This is a 003 table. As to get the 003 doc types. And this table is bound to the moment to the table backup F using the specific connection, and I will export there the surrogate key from the table okay 003 and okay convert the null values to the zero. Okay, then maybe default value I need additionally. Okay, and I hope I have every dimension which I need in my fact transformation. Now I will add some measures or some numbers. For example, in the BSEC table, there is a field. This is amount. Then we have the field. Okay, this is a quantity, amount, quantity. Then VAT and STS, I think. Well, okay, and one more field I will add. Oops, sorry, it will be not. Will be calculated field. I will calculate the one the M by the R multiply by the one mega and we'll call it total. This is a total. Okay. Now I will synchronize my data warehouse. And when I synchronize the data warehouse, the model which I created in Analytics Creator will be materialized. And the new database with the structure will be, created in on the SQL server. And okay, we synchronized the data warehouse, our model. Now we see that the doc types table and calendar table are bound to our fact transformation. Well, what additionally I will do, I will rename this fact transformation. I will call it FK, fact, I don't know, fact. And now I will add some additional measures. for my tabular OLAP cube. For example, for example, the number of customers, number of vendors, but I will more. I will, for example, number of bookings. I will have quantity, and what amount, quantity, VAT, and total. Okay, now I added some measures which will be created in my tabular OLAP cube, which I will generate. There are the names in the column parsed measure name. Sure, I can call every measure individually, but or I can use such templates like aggregation name, column name, table name, and so on. And the names of the measures will be generated automatically. It's pretty useful. Okay, well, I think I am already I'm done with the definition of my data warehouse, and now I will create the deployment package. And this deployment package will generate the Visual Studio solution for my containing the definition of my data warehouse. Okay, let me call this deployment one. Okay, we will generate the DECPAC file. We will deploy this DECPAC file from AnalyticsCreator directly. The name of the database where we will deploy to is SAP DWH. And we will generate integration service packages. And we will generate the tabular OLAP cube. And we will create a tabular OLAP cube directly on the SQL server. Okay, the OLAP cube name will be sub GWH. And okay, we'll use service account to process OLAP cube. And important is to check this checkbox. Create cube during deployment and process cube in the workflow package. It's okay. Well, I think it's I'm ready to save, and let me instead to use a service account, I will add my username. This is you. Okay, save and deploy. Now, when I deploy the data warehouse, the Visual Studio solution will be created. And this solution will contain everything what you need to deploy your data warehouse. And after the Visual Studio solution is created, you don't need AnalyticsCreator to work with this data warehouse. You can deploy it everywhere. You can deploy it on premise. You can deploy it in Microsoft Azure, to the Microsoft Azure, and you will. It is not necessary to use AnalyticsCreator anymore to work with this data warehouse. Okay, we can see our OLAP cube. Our database was generated. We created the DECPAC file, SAP DWH DECPAC. Then DECPAC file was deployed. We created the XMLA file containing the OLAP cube definition, and this OLAP cube or this XML file was deployed to. It is not necessary to deploy from AnalyticsCreator, but for the demo purposes, we deploy immediately from when we generate the deployment packages. And now all of SSS packages will be generated. Okay, let's take a look maybe on or let's wait for the packages. They should be generated very soon. Okay, the workflow package will be generated. And okay, we are ready. Peter, how much time did we need to create the data warehouse? I think less than 30 minutes.
Yes, 30 minutes.
Okay, well, now let's take a look on the Visual Studio solution which we generated. This solution is stored in the directory C deployment and deployment. Okay, there is a special the subdirectory created and the subdirectory contains this Visual Studio solution. Let's open it. Okay, this is a Visual Studio solution generated in AnalyticsCreator, or this is a SQL Server Data Tools solution. You can see this is an integration service project. On the top, you can see the integration service packages which we generated. First of them is a workflow package. Workflow package contains every other, the call of every other package in the correct order to fulfill your ETL process. Okay, there are some errors because we have no connection to the SAP system, but you can see this is a workflow package. First we log some data, we refresh the snapshots, we start the import package, then we start the historizing package, and then there are some logging tasks. Here we will process our oracle cube generated in AnalyticsCreator, and then there are some log entries too. Okay, let's take a look on the import package which we generated. Okay, come on. You can see for every table which we import, we create there one container. That means every import and import package will be performed parallelly. We will import from different tables simultaneously, parallel. And import packages looks like pretty usual integration service packages. There is a logging task. In this task, we truncate the data from the import table. Then there is a flow task containing the import the read from the source table, then maybe some tube some transformations, and then we export export the data, we store the data in the input tables in our data warehouse. It's pretty usual, and there's nothing specific in such integration, in such import packages which we generate. Then, historizing package. This package contains only the call of the stored procedure, and we use stored procedures on the server to historize the tables. Well, let's take a look on. Okay, then we, you can see there is a deckpack file in this Visual Studio solution. You can deploy this deckpack file using SQL Server Management Studio. In the SQL Server Management Studio, to deploy the deckpack files, and you have to select the database where you will deploy to. In case the data warehouse, the database already exists, or if it is a new database, you can select the database node and click on, wait a moment, where is the deploy, exactly, deploy data to your application. In this deploy data to your application, you can select the deckpack file generated in Analytics Creator and deploy your database, or you can select existing database, in our case, for example, SAP DWH, and click on tasks, and then upgrade data to your application and select the deckpack file which was generated on Analytics Creator to deploy your database, your changes. Or you can use the specific utility of Microsoft. This is the SQL package.exe, and you can deploy your deckpack files using this SQL package.exe utility. Well, then we created the OLAP cube. We can see this OLAP cube here. Wait a moment, I will connect to my analysis services. We generated the database called SIPTWH. This is this one. Let's take a look on the structure of this database. I will open the Power BI desktop and will connect to this tabular OLAP cube, which I generated. And then we can see the structure of this OLAP cube. Okay, takes some time to start Power BI Desktop. Okay. Okay. Now I will, sorry, I will get the data from analysis services. So file for SIPTWH. Okay, and here we can see our tables. Let's take a look on the structure of this of our OLAP cube. You can see in the middle we have the fact table, fact booking, and then this is the typical star schema of our data warehouse. We have the different dimensions and the fact transformation in the middle. This fact transformation contains, you can open it, fact booking, contains the different fields and different measures which we generated, which we created in AnalyticsCreator. This is distinct count of documents, distinct count of customers, vendors, and different sums, sum of quantity, sum of total, and so on. Well, this is a typical SAP data warehouse, which we generated in only less than 30 minutes. And now maybe I will explain you I will tell you something about this model which we generated, and explain you how this data warehouse works. You can see on the left side we have the sources. There are the source tables from the SAP. If we click on any table, we can see the structure of this table, the technical field names. We can see the different business names imported from our SAP system. Well, in the staging layer, there are the corresponding tables to store the information from the SAP tables, and every table in the staging layer has the same fields like the SAP table and the corresponding field types. Okay, and the definition of the import itself is you can see in this IP square. This is the import package, and you can see here how we import the data. First, this is a mapping between the source and target fields. You can, if you want, transform the data during import. To do that, you have to define the SSS statement here to transform your data. Okay, but usually it is not necessary. We can always transform after the data are imported. You can define here the different filters, for example, to restrict the data which you will import, and these filters can be generated dynamically. For example, you can add something like boo.greater than the variable boo., and in this case we have to generate the boo.. variable. We have to add the boo.. variable and the type, for example, string, and we can boo.. And then we should define the value of this variable either using expressions. For example, if we will always only import the data for the last 2 months, we can calculate the first date of the previous month and put there the expression to calculate this date. Or if we really want to define the differential data loading, we can calculate the value of the boo.. Variable before we start integration service package and use SSS configuration table to store the value of the boo.. Variable. And then when the package will be started, the new value of the boo.. Variable will be loaded from SSS configuration table and will be used to restrict the data which we will import into the data warehouse. Okay, this is pretty useful. This is pretty easy way to use the incremental data loading. Well, additionally, you can define there the SQL scripts which will be started for prior the import and after import. Okay, that's all. Then we have there the persisted staging layer containing the historized data. We import the data and then we historize the data in this persisted staging layer. Take a look on this BKPF historized table. Every historized table has the sum structure as a source of historization plus three additional fields. Two of them you can see. There are the fields which I mean. There are, this is they are validity period of specific data row. This is a date from and date to fields containing the information about the validity period of specific data row. And additionally, we have here the new surrogate key. This is the primary key in the historizer table. The names of the fields can be configured, can be changed, but then they should be unique for the full data warehouse and should remain as the same in the data warehouse, such field names like .bizhist, .fonthist, and .sats.id in our case. Okay, but as I said, historization, this is a typical slow changing dimension historization. Every data row in the historizer table has the surrogate key and has a validity period, you can very widely configure your historization. And to configure your historization, you should click on HP square. This is a historization package definition. And here, very important, you can define on the field level which kind of historization you will use for every field. The standard historization type, this is SCD2. SCD2 means that the history of the changes in this specific field will be stored in the historization table. In case the field was changed, the previous version of the data row will be closed and the new data row with the new validity period will be added to historizer table. For every field, you can change the historization type. For example, SCD1 means if the field was changed and only this field, for example, was changed, no history will be stored in the historizer table, but the according field in the actual data row in the historizer table will be changed. That means if the history of the changes of specific field is not necessary, if it is not necessary to store the history, you can use SCD1 historization type. Or you can select, for example, none for the field which changes for you are uninteresting, if it is not necessary to if the fields are unimportant. Sometimes, for example, you have some technical fields in your tables which will be changed very often, and to save place in your historization table, you can exclude such fields from the historization, and in case only such fields will be changed, no historization will be performed. But important, if any other change will be, if any other field will be changed, the according fields with the historization of type none will be stored in the new historizer data row too. Okay. Then what we can define additionally, we can, for example, at the moment, if you don't fill the to historize the date of historization will be used, the technical date of historization will be used to calculate the validation period, the validity period of specific data row. For example, if we historize the data in the night, then the date when the historization was performed will be used as the date of historization. Instead, you can use the existing field from your table. For example, if you have the field modify date in your table containing the date when the data row was changed, you can use such field in your historization to calculate the date of historization. Okay, you can select what you will do with the missing data rows. For example, you will historize the data and there are some missing data rows in your imported data. Some data rows were deleted, for example. In this case, usually the data in your historization table will be closed. That means the valid to die date will be set to the historization date. Sometimes you will avoid the closing of the historized data, and in this case you can set the historization type of do not close. In this case, if the data in the data source were deleted, the according data in your historized table remain open, and you can continue to use them in your data warehouse. Or, for example, you can add the empty record. It's interesting in case, for example, sometimes the data will be in your the historized data will be deleted and then added again. And in this case, the gaps can be created in the historized tables, and to close such gaps in the data, you can fill such gaps with the empty record. Anyway, it is pretty interesting, and sometimes it is pretty useful to add such empty records to the historized table to close the historization gaps. Okay, you can create the calculated columns where you can, for example, calculate the difference between the new and the data row and the previous data row. You can define the different filters, for example, to historize not all the data, but only the data for a specific time period. You can use the variables to define such filters in this case, you can use the dynamically as the dynamic filters and so on. As I said, our historization is very, very, very powerful, and you can configure it very widely. You can ever use the existing historization. Imagine your data source you will historize is already historized, and you can take this historization into the data warehouse historization table, and it is possible too. Well, then on the next layer we have there the core layer, and you can see there's different blue squares. There are the transformations. Usual transformation analytics creator, this is the view. View can be generated by analytics creator automatically. You can, in this case, this is just a regular transformation. You can create the views manually. In this case, this is a manual transformation in analytics creator. You can use SQL scripts and storage procedures to transform your data. You can ever create your own SSS packages and use them to transform the data. In this case, you will use external transformation, such transformation called external transformation analysis creator. You can ever create your own exap programs and call them and run them in analytics creator workflow. It is possible too. Okay, let's take a look on such transformation and analytics creator. Okay, this transformation was created by the data warehouse wizard, and you can see there is a definition of such transformation. Okay, and analytics creator based on this definition will create the view, and the view text we can see here on the view tab. This is pretty simple transformation. There is only one table used as source for this transformation, and then we expose every field from this table in this view. Additionally, what we do, we convert the technical names into the business names. For example, instead to call the field RADAT, we call the field in our view changed. We loaded this, we store this information in our, we stored this information in our data source, because in the data source we can store together the information about the technical names and different business names. And the Baha'i wizard used the business names to create such transformations. Okay, now what is interesting here, there are predefined transformations. Let me delete every predefined transformation, store it, and take a look on our view. We can see in the view, every field will be exposed to as is, without any transformation, only the field names will be changed. Sometimes it is necessary to add transformations based on the field type. For example, we will remove trailing and leading spaces from every character field. We can do it manually for every field separately. To do that, we can store here, we can add here the statement and put the, I don't know, L trim, and the field name, or instead of field name, we can use this statement. This is just the alias for these fields. But in this case, I should select every character field in my view and put this statement manually. Instead, to do that, I can use the predefined transformations. And let me use it, save. And if I take a look on my view, I will see there is a rtrim, ltrim statements applied for to every varchar or nvarchar field in my transformation. Then we'll, for example, convert every varchar or nvarchar max to the nvarchar or varchar 8000. Additionally, I will, I will convert every mal string to the string containing n.a, not available. And let me do that. And I will take a look on my transformation. You can see rtrim, ltrim, and then is null field name n.a. As I said, it's pretty easy transformation, but it can save you a lot of time if you if you have very much fields and if you will perform some transformation based on the field type. You can you can change any predefined transformation delivered by AnalyticsCreator. You can add your own predefined transformation, which if you want, no problem. Important is, for example, I have the transformation string null to an R, and for example, imagine you will change it, and you can change this transformation here in AnalyticsCreator, and every transformation used this predefined transformation will be changed to this the central place to perform some changes over all objects in the data warehouse. Okay, then let's take a look on our fact transformations. It's more interesting what happens here. AnalyticsCreator found that the BSEC table is bound or has the relations to different other transformations. Such relations between the table BSEC, BKPF, T001, SKB1, and so on, this information this was stored as source reference in our connector. We used the meta connector to create our data warehouse, and the information about the references between the fields is stored in this connector. And this information was used to create this fact transformation. And important is every table here, which we use in this transformation, this is a historized table. And it is sometimes pretty difficult to join the historized tables because their primary keys, the business primary keys in the historized tables aren't primary keys anymore. We can have several different data rows with the same business key in our historized table. And to be able to join the historized tables, we used here the snapshot historization. Let's take a look on the view which was generated in AnalyticsCreator. And you can see there are the different SAP tables, and we use the business relationships to join the table together. But additionally, we have here one table called CFG snapshots, and this table contains the snapshot dates. This table contains at least one data row with the actual date. And imagine you have in this table only one row containing the actual date in the field snapshot date, and then we join there the historized table, and from every historized table we get the data which are actual for specific snapshot date. You can see every table which we join has this join condition, snapshot date between date from and date to. Using this condition, we can restrict the data which we load from every historized table. We get only the data which are actual for specific snapshot date. And in this case, if there is only one actual date in the snapshot table, only actual data will be exposed by this fact transformation. But you can add more snapshots to the snapshot table. You can define, for example, the last day of the previous month, last day of the previous month, and so on, the different snapshots in the past. And in this case, our fact table will show you not only the actual data, but the data from the past, the previous versions of the data which were valid for the specific snapshot date. And the snapshot table, this service table, later will be used in the data mart layer as the snapshot dimension. And you can use this snapshot dimension, if you define more snapshot than only one actual date, to get the old version of your data, the historical data. This is some kind of additional timeline, of additional time axis, which you can use to access the historical data. And it's sometimes very interesting. You can create, for example, the measures which will calculate the differences between the different snapshots. You can provide the timeline in the data warehouse where is no timeline at all. And this snapshot dimension can be used as a calendar dimension, as really as timeline. But if you don't need the historical data, for example, you can use instead of snapshot historization type, the actual only historization type. And if we do it, let's take a look on our view. There is no snapshot dimension, and but there is one additional where condition. This dot bishist is equal 9999 12 31. This is the okay the attribute how we can get only the actual data from our historized table, and you can use the actual only historization to if you don't need if the historical information is uninteresting for you. Well, then one more thing which I will show you, this is the macros. In this case, we used this macro subdate to ID to convert the SAP date into ID from calendar dimension. What is this macro? It is something very simple. Let me show you where the macro. For example, we have there the macro called date to ID. Let me show this macro to you. The macro, it is just the SQL Server's SQL statement or the transact SQL statement, where some parts of the statement was replaced by such placeholders. This double dot one, this is a placeholder. And then when we call the macro, this double dot one will be replaced by the first parameter which we use together with the macro. Would we have the double dot two? The double dot two would be replaced by the second parameter and so on. And this macro just convert the date into ID from calendar dimension. Is pretty easy. There is one statement, date div, using date div statement, it will calculate the number of dates between the year 1980 and the current date, and this number of date, this is ID from calendar dimension. Calendar dimensions was created by data warehouse wizard, and this macro will be used to convert the date into ID from this calendar dimension. We used, instead to use the date to ID macro, we used the macro subdate to ID. The reason is that the SAP date, it is not the date, but the string containing the string in format year, month, date. To convert such macro, such date into ID from calendar dimension, we use another macro. First, we convert the subdate into the usual date using this convert function, and then we call macro date to ID to convert the date into ID from calendar dimension. You can call macros in macros. It is no problem. In this case, we used date to ID macro in the subdate to ID macro. And what is the result of this macro? You can see we call here the subdate to ID, and in our view, we have this SQL statement. This SQL statement, this macro call was replaced by the macro statement, and the double dot one was replaced by, in our case, T2BOO.,. But this is a booking date field from our source table. Well, as I said, the macros, it's pretty, really very interesting feature of AnalyticsCreator. First, you can pack some small transformations or transformation bricks into such macros. Later, the macros will be the central place for such small transformations. And if I would change the macro, every transformation where the macro was used will be changed too. In this case, it is not necessary to open every transformation and do the changes in every transformation. Only I have to change the macro. Okay, well, what is what? I think it's all what I will explain you today. If you have the questions, please ask me. And
Did anybody have a question for Dimitri? He can show you something if you are interested.
Well, then I think when there is no questions, Peter, if you want, you can add something, and we can.
Everybody wants to go in the garden and look for the Easter surprise.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah, thanks a lot to joining us, Analytics Creator Virtual Classroom. Yeah, wish you a nice Easter festival.